nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back. I'm Professor Rickus. In this lecture, we're going to talk about cells as biosensors. We're going to divide this into a couple parts. So in this lecture, we're going to cover what is a biosensor, what are some of the key performance criteria, we'll look at some biological examples, and talk about translation to biohybrid devices. So what is a biosensor? So a biosensor is simply a device that detects and reports the presence of and or quantity of some biological entity. So detects implies that there's some recognition event. And recognition usually occurs in the cellular world via molecular binding and interaction. So the word reports in our definition implies that this recognition event must be transduced into some signal that we can measure. And our biological target, this entity that we're interested in, can really be anything that's biological in nature, molecules, cells, viruses, all sorts of things that we're interested in measuring. So the components of a biosensor, we have some target, this biological entity. This is the thing, what it is you want to measure. So there's a recognition element, and this is the component that detects or recognizes this target. There's a transducer that converts this recognition event into some measurable signal. Of course, we have to measure that signal now with a detector. And often then there's some sort of display or conversion that makes the measurement readable to our end user, usually us, right? Who gets the information? So there are several key performance or design criteria of a biosensor. We can talk about its sensitivity, which we'll go into in more depth in upcoming lecture. We can talk about the detection limit. This is essentially how few of the entities need to be around before that our sensor can detect their presence. Selectivity, how well our sensor can detect one component versus some other similar component. Okay. And dynamic range is sort of this range on the bottom limit is our detection limit. And the range is, do we get so many that we can no longer count them or tell the difference anymore? And response time, how quickly do we get a signal out of our system? So there are many others as I have listed here, but these five are really the key driving performance criteria of most sensors. So let's refresh ourselves. In a prior lecture, we did a case study of a sensor looking at the photoreceptor in the retina, right? So remember that a rod photoreceptor as a sensor can detect a single photon with incredibly low dark noise. It essentially generates its own power from molecular food. It's adaptive and is a near perfect photon counter. And we talked about how it's comprised of organic biological parts that are organized with a particular microstructure to enable some of these functions. And in lots of ways, I would argue rivals many of our human-made solid-state photodetectors. So looking at a photoreceptor as an ultimate engineered biosensor, right? So just to remind you that we have already looked at a biosensor in a prior lecture. We also talked about the cognitive problem of the cell. And I bring this back up here because it really articulates how that cells are natural sensors. It's part of their job that they must do to survive. They must sense their extracellular environment, right? Are there available nutrients around? And if so, which ones? So that a cell can decide which enzymes it needs to make in order to metabolize that molecular food that it's surrounded by. Are there stressors around that it needs to swim away from? In the case of bacteria, for example, mechanical and chemotactic signals and others. Are there other cells around? And if so, what kind? Right? So the cells have to sense that information and transduce that into a measurable signal that the cell itself can respond to. So in this case, it's all internal to the cell. But again, I wanted to highlight how cells are really natural sensors. So a lot of what's happened in many of our biohybrid devices using whole cells as biosensors, we are hijacking and coupling into the native systems and redesigning them and putting in outputs that we can measure. So looking at it from this view, you can also think of yourself. Your human body is a biosensor, right? So your body alerts your brain to the presence of molecules around it, right? Your brain uses this information to make decisions. You know that a piece of food is rancid by its unpleasant odor, right? And you've evolved some inherent mechanisms that make that gross to you. Right? You can recognize a person around the corner by their signature perfume. You naturally reject poisonous or indigestible plants due to their bitter taste, right? So in this sense, you are a biosensor. So if we look at it from this way and sort of map you and what's happening in your body onto our map of a biosensor, our target in this case is some odorant, right? We have receptors in the nose. These are proteins that bind these molecules and recognize molecules and patterns of those molecules. And that gets transduced in the neurons in the nose into a signal that is measurable by the brain, right? And that brain basically converts that into a sensation that you experience that essentially become the display to you, the end user. And so again, just continuing with this, right? This molecule now is your analyte. And looking at a cartoon now of what I just described graphically and conceptually. So here what we have air and odorant molecules passing by some of the receptors in the olfactory epithelium. In this case, we're looking at in this mucosa here. Right? And so these neurons in this olfactory epithelium, they detect these odorants and convert this into signals that get communicated into the cells in the olfactory bulb that communicate this through the olfactory tract now onto your brain. Okay? So the reason why I show you this example and go on with it for a little bit is that it really feeds into our concept of biohybrids. So here I pose this question, what if we could replace the brain with a human-made detector, right? Something, an array of an electrodes, for example, and take away this olfactory bulb and now lay a detector, again, perhaps a microelectrode array, directly on our neurons in our olfactory epithelium, right? And now connect that detector to some display and output that we could read on a computer. You've now made a biohybrid device, right? You've made an odorant biosensor biohybrid device. And this actually has been an active area of research for a while now in a field called the artificial nose, right? So this would be one way to couple in a natural system with an engineered system to create a functional sensor and an output that we could read on the computer to tell us something about the odorants in the air. Okay, now that we've done that introduction, next coming up, we're going to dive a little bit more deeply into cells as sensors. And specifically, we're going to talk about sensitivity, one of our critical design parameters, and talk about the design principles that are inherent in natural cells, and then how we can take advantage of those design principles and engineer them into our biohybrid devices to make new types of biosensors using whole living cells. I hope to see you next time.